Thanks. Good morning, everyone. This next section is about modeling. And of course, when we talk about monitoring, we can talk about two aspects, and that's measurements and modeling. The measurements have been discussed, and you can go to one location, and you can measure the soundscape at a location with a very high temporal coverage. And what you measure is everything that's going on there. So that's we really know what's the soundscape at that location. And modeling has a different approach and a different application, actually. With modeling, you can extend this to many more locations than you will ever physically be able to measure. So you have a much higher spatial coverage of the area. And you can distinguish much more easily the individual contributions of the different sources that contribute to your sound field. So if you want to use the monitoring data in order to regulate, for example, if you want to know, is this, do I need to do something about shipping? Do I need to control piling? Do I need to do something else? The modeling is going to tell you what the contribution of this part of this typical source is. So if you're just interested in one of these, it's better to rely on models that model this component than to try to measure everything that's going on at a certain location. As discussed, TT Noise, or Europe actually at the moment, considers that risk assessment should be taken on the basis of both spatial and temporal characteristics. They're talking about for the setting of thresholds on tolerable impacted area and tolerable duration, both of them. So from that point of view, spatial coverage is important, and modeling then gives you the possibility to do so. So model-based risk assessment, et cetera, there are many reasons why you would want to model. And the modeling that we do is for these large area is something where we do not focus on what's happening at a certain location at a certain time. We try to get an overview of what's going on in a certain area. So we make statistical sound maps that quantify the spatial and temporal distribution of the underwater sound. We know that sound particle motion may be important for several species, but up to now, being able to measure that is not a standard practice yet, and it's something that needs to be developed. We're working on aspects like that in other projects. The current projects that we are discussing now are focusing on sound pressure level as a metric for the sound field. And for the sound sources for the modeling in Geomapons, we decided, well, let's focus on the two sources where we have control, which we can model clearly and which we think are important and which were also seen as important by the EU. That's the ships that cause the continuous background sound. And then there's wind that's always there as a proxy for the natural sound. So we decided to start modeling these first two sources and then see in the measurements how well the models represent the situation. How important are the sources that we do not model? That's what the measurements are supposed to tell us. To be able to model these, we need to know where the sources are, how they're behaving, what their source level is, and we need to know how the sound that's produced by these sources propagates in the environment, and then things like the local water depth, the geoacoustic parameters, the sound speed profiles, the sea surface properties, all have an effect. Those are things we try to take into account while remaining pragmatic, and so try to take only into account the parts that you can take and that are most relevant. Well, for the in Geomapons, We made sound maps after an initial process together with some partners where we benchmarked models, made a choice for models. We picked a modeling approach that was pragmatic for the large scale. And we modeled the sound from ships and wind in over a frequency range of 10 hertz to 20 kilohertz in all the decade bands that are there. We modeled over various depths, but in the end, we presented the results in frequency decade bands, a depth average results. And then, we at various temporal scales, and the images that I show here give the temporal median, so the 50th percentile over a month of the sound field in these three bands. And as you see, frequency matters. At low frequency, ship noise is producing all these yellow and red areas in the North Sea, and at higher frequencies, the enhanced levels due to ships are much more localized around the main shipping lanes. It's a choice which metric to present in these maps, and well, we've made some proposals from the Geomapan's point of view, but the harmonization of these metrics is still an issue, and is relevant. It's very important for comparison between various projects, and I think that our journalist colleagues will come back to that in the next presentation. Then, of course, we can make maps, but we need to know what's the quality of these maps. They need to be validated somehow, and there should be some correspondence to what we are measuring and what we are modeling. Well, in the Geomapan's project, we had a separate group. It's CFAS was responsible for bringing the measurements and the modeling together, so that we did an independent modeling and independent measurements to make sure that we have a good prediction without being able to tune our models to data, etc. So these are independent sets, and they were compared, and the differences were quantified. And this led to the publication that Fritjof already noted earlier this year. Ross Putland from CFAS, together with the TNO colleagues, we wrote a paper on the observations. And yes, there are differences between modeled ship noise and wind noise and the sound that's measured at locations. And these differences are partly due to that the models have uncertainties, but they're also certainly due to the fact that the measurements have uncertainties. We've calibrate the equipment, so we know that the sound pressure measurements of the equipment are relatively stable and relatively certain within a few dB. But what in the sound field is that you're measuring there, what contributes to it, and whether that matches with the models, it's not only because we do not because the models for ship noise are not exactly predicting what's happening. It's also that things that we are not modeling can be contributing to the sound field. And some first comparisons were made, some first analysis of the data was made to try to establish which part of the measured sound is actually ship and wind, and how does that correlate with the modeling. But still, a lot of data is there, and a lot of work can be done and needs to be done to further quantify what we actually see in the measurements. And do we need to extend the modeling, for example, with other types of sound generation, especially, for example, measurement stations near to platforms, etc. We showed enhanced sound levels that were not predicted by the shipping models, and that are very likely due to the sound from the platforms. The main uncertainties that we came to are associated with, well, the input of the data for the models. AIS, I'll come back to that, is a source of uncertainty. And then also in the propagation, it's mainly the geoacoustic parameters that are not very well specified everywhere and that have an impact on the modeling. The ships, being AIS, the automated identification of ships, tells you about shipping traffic, but then when you know where ships are, you also need to know how much sound they make. And we work together with the Canadian research program near the port of Vancouver, where they measured a lot of ships, and we used their database together with our modeling approach to come up with an updated ship source level model, which was published last year, and which was used as a starting point for the predictions. And this source level model identifies for various ship types and how much sound they produce, dependent on the speed at which the ships sail and dependent on the size of the ship. So there are a number of parameters in that. It is a statistical model, and for individual ship passages, there are differences up to plus or minus 6 dB for individual ships. But for the average ship, so for the monthly statistics that we're predicting, this reduces to much smaller uncertainties. As said, AIS is telling us where the ships are, and AIS databases can be provided. There are several providers available. Coverage of the AIS of the ships depends on where do you get the data, from land stations, from satellites. It depends on the weather, how well do the stations receive the signals from the ships. It depends on the transponders on the ships, whether they're switched on or off, for example, whether they operate correctly. And we see that in the center of the North Sea, the coverage is not always as good as we expect. And if we look to individual tracks of ships, we see ships leaving Scotland and then disappearing and reappearing near the Danish coast. And so we know that some part of the information is missing. So a part of the processing of AIS includes completing these tracks, trying to get data at a regular time grid and trying to fill in the gaps. And of course, there are uncertainties. If the time that the ship is missing should match with the speed, and you can assume that the ship sailed a constant course, that's the only thing you can do. If the ship didn't do that, then we just don't know. So there is uncertainties, but you can enhance the data set significantly, and that's what we did. So the number of ships in the interpolated data set is about 20% to 30% higher than the number of ship messages is 20% to 30% higher than the actual available data. Moreover, in the AIS, also the ship type and length information is not always correct, and there's different information on the ship types. And that's another point where there's no standardization. What is a ship type? When is a ship a cargo ship? When is it a container? When it's a bulker? AIS has some identification, but not very clear. We had input from our Canadian friends on how to characterize ships, and there are some types that are not directly available in the AIS, so there's uncertainties in this as well. And the source level model says, if a ship is a container ship, it has a certain source level, but how do you determine which ship is a container ship? There are some uncertainties there as well, so there's more work to be done there. We compared in the extension from Jongepans, we compared the data from two different AIS providers, because we had a different provider for 2020 than for 2019. The new provider also gave us data for May 2019, and we saw differences between the same month provided by different providers. And it's mainly related to spatial coverage. We found out that in the old data set that we used for the 2019 maps, particularly around Scotland, we just missed a number of ships that were present in the next data set. It's related to ship type, it's related to coverage, there are just differences, and there's not much harmonization or standardization available yet. In the end, we made statistical sound maps, one sound map every 10 minutes for the whole year, for 2 years then, 2019 and 2020, and we have got the contribution of wind and individual ship types. And what we conclude from that in the end is we can compare ships with wind. So the percentage of the time over which the SPL of the ships exceeds a special threshold value is one of the things that's being considered as a metric for the impact of the ship's noise. What we did in Jongepans up to now is we identified the difference between actual ship noise and wind noise at every instance. And when this difference is more than 20 dB, we made the map black, and we indicated what percentage of the time this occurred. Others have proposed, well, let's just take a fixed SPL value as a threshold. That's a threshold, a level where animals may be sensitive at a specific SPL. And the same plot can be made, and they look very similar. So the models help to identify which kind of metrics can be used, what the differences between metrics are, and they support the discussions that are now going on in the various working groups. And the time is short, but we are still at the evaluation of comparisons like this. Frequency matters, so there's a big difference for this metric between the different frequency ranges, and they are related to different animals. So that's another thing to consider. There's no fixed threshold for one type of animals. And picking one of the metrics, and I'm going I don't want to spend too much time on this, but what we have now is the sound maps for 2 years, 2019, 2020, and we looked to variation over the months of the index, well, the metric that says how much, what percentage of the time and what percentage of the area of the North Sea is exceeded for exceeds the limit. And there's an index that we can say, and that varies over the months. And it mainly varies over the months because the wind noise varies over the months. Actually, the ship noise is quite stable. So our index, it says, well, there's more difference between ships and wind in the summer because the wind is lower. So it's not easy to interpret these metrics. We also looked to the comparison between the years 2019 and 2020 because of this pandemic where the ship traffic was affected. And actually in our evaluation up to now, we are on the global scale, we don't see any this clear differences with COVID. Locally, there are differences. For specific ship types, there are differences. But for the total sound field in the North Sea, there's not a clear effect visible. So, to conclude, these statistical sound maps are useful as input for the environmental status assessment, and they can be extended to other sources if these are seen in the data. Uncertainties are mainly due to uncertainties in the model input, so the coverage of the ship traffic and the ship parameters, and for a part also the geoacoustic parameters. And yeah, as said, the harmonization between projects is very important, and I think that's a nice bridge to the next presentation. So thank you.